to transport policies in Pemba or Able, but due to the events on Saturday, as we all know, we're actually supposed to have quite a few officers from the Met here today. But due to the events on Saturday, a lot of them have been drafted back to work. And to deliver his presentation, we have another representative of Able in the house, Billy Savage, who also happens to be a magistrate. So she will be talking to us about Able and about Mr. Ezekiel's presentation. Can I also have Jennifer Obaseki? A round of applause for her. Thank you. Can I have the CEO of NUS, Lade Olukwemi, and following on will be Dr. Ayodele Ajayi, consultant, psychiatrist, exorcism, and engagement with mental health services. Wow. Thank you. Now, this is the way we will stick to the time, and you know me very well. As soon as you're running over your time, I'll stand by you. So please, so that we can have enough time for the panel discussion. So can I ask Florence Emokosa?
My name is Florence Amakusi. I'm the pioneer of World of Hope. Briefly, World of Hope is an organization that started 11 years ago, which is still going on by the grace of God. We have different services. We have some list there, which we have advice and information, one-to-one and group support, befriending and bodies, mentoring, street outreach, residential trip, different. Figure. And that is why we that were all here today, we need to have at least one child to mentor. Please, if there's anything you're taking home today, take that home. Look for, not your children, look for another child out there. Mentor them. Please. They will live and grow up to be a blessing to you. Please. It's a seed you are sowing into the future of your own children. So that is how God of Hope started, to not to waste our time. So the organization is now expanded and we've got more branches. We started with one borough, we're now, we've occupied 5 to 6 boroughs now. We should see the list here. And I just gave you a list of what we do. Then street outreach, my team normally go on the street to engage with young people. And what we were doing, that was most task I've ever enjoyed in the organization. Like our gang leaders. You see that? Most of the time we break gangs on the street to tell you the hard work we started the organization with. And that is why the recognition started coming up from the police. Police come and say, Florence, please do not use your money. They first put £3,000. And when police could see the organization put money there, just know you are doing it well. And that is how more opportunity begin to go home office. You know, I work for all of them were not giving us money. So by doing that, we were able to now equip young people, taking them on a trip, weekend, with the training. You know, then we have workshops. By the time they come back, whatever we identify as an issue that we equip them with, they are coming back to put together an information booklet. If you look at this, I'm sure most of you have gotten it. This was put together by parents who have been affected with the issue of chastisement. Okay, so the same thing we do with young people. And they are so proud of it. Okay? Then with the parental support, we've been identified in most of the world as organization that is really meeting the needs of BMA parents in terms of the cultural clash that my sister Atos Ndekede was talking initially as well. You know, so now we get contracts from some local authorities, so we provide the training for them. You know, they refer to us and the children involved as well. Then the church services. So they normally contract us as well to run the training for their staff, even though they are managers, so that they will understand where BMA are coming from. You know, because it is easy for a parent.
What is BMA?
Black
minority ethnic group.
Does that make sense? Like me and you,
BMA.
Okay, some people call it BMA. Some people call it BME. So don't worry, it's the same thing. So, but I will not waste your time. A lot of like I said, I will say that. What I just want to concentrate on the issues that we're dealing with. Yeah? These are the common things we identify in most of the cases we're dealing with. We've learned that language barrier. You know, an African lady like me, we suit up, we dress, we make up. But mind you, most of them are not educated. You see that? And one of the issues we identify that when they are caught up and they are going through different processes with local authority, they have to go to different meetings, case conference, call group. You know, a lady like me, we suit up, we sit in that meeting, whatever they are saying, yes, yes, yes. And she did not hear one jargon they're talking about. So this is where we step in. We take them to that meeting. We talk to them what they should be expecting in that meeting. All the jargons, you know, we explain it to them. And if there's anything to be challenged, we challenge it. So then, lack of integration into the UK system. We realize that, especially Nigerians, when we come to UK, we lack that integration, whereby me as a Yoruba lady, as I come to UK, I'm going to reside with a Yoruba family. And a Yoruba family already, they've already established a Yoruba church or Yoruba mosque. Then they live in a Yoruba community. And when they want to do shopping, they are going to do shopping with a Yoruba person that runs the stores. You see that? So in a way, we are covering our home. We are not exposed So we do it to understand what the system is all about in this country. You see that? So that is another thing we're trying to break that barrier. You know, we working with local authority and working with the parents to break that barrier. It's a big barrier. Then covering up and lack of support for one another. This is one of the ethnic minority that I identified that. This neighbor, flat one, flat two, flat three, this one, the child has been taken to care because you use broom to wipe the head. And the flat three, he doing the same thing. And this child has been taken away from flat A, flat A, then flat B, he's doing the same thing. And the flat A will be looking at us, continue doing it, and your own children are be taken away. You don't want this one to know what is happening, and you cannot help this one to stop what she's doing. Did you see what I'm trying to say now? This is the community, and we need to break that barrier. If my children were taken away because I used boom or omorogu to beat them, I should be able to see another one doing the same thing, to say, please. I'm just going through the same thing. It is not palatable. Stop it. Put them through the process. That is what education does. All of us coming here today, we should be catalysts for change. Not just coming here because they do not even know anything about the system. They will be the one, your friend will be the one, just know anything, be able to tell you, say, services have come to your house. Don't even open your door. Don't open your door. You see that? And in the process of you not open your door to social services and you have done something they need to intervene, it will make the matter worse. Did you see that? You don't want to die, but you are pulling big wood on your head that is going to kill you. So you might as well. Now tell me, what did you take care of it? Now when we do party, we rent a hall of £6,000. What did you get out of it? At the end of the day, our children are suffering.
It's true.
I urge you, please, Nigerians, my fellow Nigerians, if you are bringing up younger children, if you still need to stay in council flat, please do so with dignity and pride. Rather than to go for a bigger house and, you know, take a mortgage that you need to work 24 hours. Husband is coming in, the wife is coming in. Because some family, the children will be, the husband will take the children at the train station.
Okay.
The train is about to come down. Okay, I'm waiting outside. Boom, taking the children. You see that? And there is no intimacy. You see, it's very sad. You see, Asian family, their wife will not work during the time they're bringing their children up. It's a sacrifice, and it's very rewarding. It's a matter of time. Let's cut what we buy as at that time. You know, if it would take me not to buy lace, at least belly of now. Please, must I wear a lace of time for a pound when I cannot afford it? Please, food for thought. Okay, we need to spend time with our children. A child is coming from school. Nobody going to ask, how was your period today? What did you do in the classroom? All we are doing is that your biscuit is on the table, please. Yeah, I've left your tea, I've left a cup of drink. Make sure you don't mess up with the house. Make sure you don't beat your brother. Make sure you don't open the door for stranger. Okay, I'll see you tomorrow. By the time they're coming back, they should be sleeping. What kind of lifestyle is that? No, we need to face the fact. Nobody wants to pay any price anymore. Especially we, young parents, who might be doing rosy. It doesn't work like that. If you want these children to grow up, to pay you your labor that you have labored for them, you need to suffer for it at this stage. And it's very rewarding. Please, take them home and tell our friend for me, please. Then we encourage parents to engage. Learn to speak out. When I say engage, when church service, when you use the mopping stick to break the child, head. And they come to you, they go to school and say, Miss Rose, look at my head, I see blood there. And then Miss Rose will ask, okay, John, come inside. We now call a parent, please, when you're coming to pick these children this afternoon, just come straight to the office. Mother knows what she has done before she left the household. And the mother will say, hey, that boy, If you know how much I used to bring this boy from Nigeria, how much I paid when he was coming, thinking that he would come here and be the best boy because of the opportunity in UK. What kind of opportunity? When you are breaking their brain. No, where is the opportunity going to be utilized? So we have to, please, let's educate ourselves. A lot is going on. I have seen a family whereby a toddler, well beaten up, broke with broken hand, and they cannot take this child to the hospital because what are they going to tell the doctor? And nowadays, doctor and police, they are not far from each other in the hospital. You see that? Oh, all right, I behave myself. Yes. Okay. These are the common things that make us to lose our children to the system. Unloved placement. Please take your time to go through this leaflet. If you are used to using belts to discipline your child, because you think that is the best way the child will be the best child in this world, think twice. So, and discipline a child in anger. My colleagues have said they don't need to even go to jail. Neglect, most of the children, as I said, we neglect them, we leave them in the house. We lock them up, we say that, okay, in a 6-year-old, we look after 3 years old, now what's wrong with you? We lock them up, we put food on the table to look after each other. This is England. This is, so let's think twice. As if you call Home Alone. Did you watch Home Alone before? If you don't watch, please talk to your children to say, there's a film, one woman say Home Alone. Can you show me so that I can watch it? You will see what they call disaster. Or even a child in the house. If you are watching, I say, my Nigerians need to watch this. You know, very interesting. And it's very educative, please. You know? So, then, use it as weapon. Sometimes, all these things we think that we are using to discipline our children, in this conflict, count as a weapon. Using belt, slippers, mopping stick, broom. Oh, some will say, turn your head. By the time I use broom to wipe it, all the bad luck will be flat out of the head. Who told you the child has a bad luck? Our children are the best gift we could ever have in life. We need to start thinking or reorientate our mindset, how we see our children in this country. Who told you that we haven't done anything worse than what they are doing? When I'm training a parent, I was a parent, when I was training him, I said, okay, can you let us share one of the worst things you've done when you're age 10? The man laughed. And this is the man that used something to hit the child that the end was bleeding. The man laughed. He said, do you know what I'm doing? I said, what were you laughing? He said, he was happy because one day that he carried their father's palm wine to school to go and give his class. He said it was a fun to him. He said, but the way their father beat him that day. I said, in fact, because you are I'm your trainer, I cannot make any comments. How can you carry palm wine to school? Number one, you drop them. Then they start, is it the teacher they will rape or they will beat? Do you know what they can do? As part of, you know, this, you see, we are all laughing now. But when I was talking to this man, the man now began to think deeply, to say, wow, he now began to regret why he treated his son that way. Because he had done something worse, and the boy has not done 10% of what he had done. And he never breathed the head. So let's think twice. If you think we have not been a child before, please, let's call our parents to remind us, because the time might be too long. Yeah? Please. Okay? Consequences. When all this thing is echoing, when it occurs, you will be arrested. You see, police will be in the house. Then, prison. I have seen many Nigerian parents, that you use omorogun to hit your child. You didn't mean to hurt that child, but it is not an appropriate thing because you are angry already. You are bound to hit that child in the wrong place. Some children died in the process. Let's think for the worst that could happen. Some children died in the process. Please. So, prison is there for the house of a parent that could not comply with the law in the UK.
Yeah? Okay.
Then children be taken into foster. Is that what we want? Is that what we want? The one that is even going to order our who has been praying every night. We are anointing them. We are talking to them. were doing everything. Then after the one you now take away to a total stranger, who told you that foster parents know everything about your child? Yes, they are there timely because that child needed to be placed in his pure hand. That is what they are there for, and their money salary is going up. If they don't pay them, they won't do it. Please, don't let us do anything that will make us to lose our children out of our care. Please, I plead all of us.
Then, family separation. I have seen it happen here. You see, some in the process, the father will be deported
to Nigeria.
Do we really need that?
Do you know, when we were living in Nigeria, the way people were looking at us, so can you guys have flashback? They get you. And in your father and your mother, I know most of us were young when we were coming. Don't think that we can't forget that moment. It was the best time of our life. The way we were, you know, we feel. To say, yes, I'm going to abroad. You see that? And you'll be thinking that in the next 5 years, by the time I return, I will buy a car, I will build a house, I will do this. You see, this is a dream. And when this occurs, the dream will be wiped out overnight. No, let's be realistic. The dream will be wiped out overnight.
Yeah?
Then, loss of income. Nowadays, it's even worse now. Do you know what they call Lado? I mean, who know about Lado? If you're a professional, you're working with vulnerable adult or children, and all this thing happen in your care. First thing they do, they will call them. They will report you to them that you are not fit to be in your workplace. What the first thing is to suspend. You see that? And when they suspend, oh, they don't give you income. They won't pay you. No. You see that? So is that what we want? There's so much to lose. Health implication. I have seen a parent this size when the thing just happened. Within 3 weeks, half of the size. No, it just. It's very, very alarming, you know? And I begin to ask the mom, do you even sleep at all? Me sleep? Of course, even though sleep will not come. I try to lie down, sleep will not come. You see that? And what they'll be saying is that, oh, I miss these children. You see that? Now I used to think that they're bad. Now I'm missing that. I just wish they're in my house and I'm misbehaving. I will take them. And by the time these children return, they are demanding for what they were giving them over there that you cannot afford to give to them. And in the process, you beat them again. Then you will take them permanently. So what do we want? Okay. I promise to be myself. See that? Lastly, I just want to talk briefly that last year, we had this event here. I want to talk about the power of community spirit. When we had this event last year, we had the BBC one here. Somebody among us, I don't know, the person recorded and sent the clip all over, and people were circulating it. Can you believe that December this year, people were now picking it up again, circulating it? It was from there that I was called from Manchester. They went to Google my details. And that has opened doors because, number one, my sister was there. We all did it together then. You see that? And after that, all of us as a group will be going to the mosque. You know, in fact, I still have a mosque to go to now. You understand? So I want to tell us that community spirit is the best thing. Let's help each other. Let's come together. You see, so probably the person that recorded it didn't even come. But what did he do? He did his own part. And from that clip, everybody had been getting the message. In fact, from there as well, church services were contacting me to say, Florence, there was one statement you made to say, if we identify it is an issue, we should render support so that there wouldn't be, you know, the issue whereby they will be locking our people up, you know, penalizing them, and let us come together, equip ourselves to be a better parent to raise our children so that we can break the circle of bringing children that they're ending up in prison, The children that they are mocking each other, you know, they offend each other, they can't even settle amicably. What did they do? Knife. It is very sad. These are all the root of the issue. If we don't spend time with our children, you know, the bad one will spend time with them and they will teach them what they don't need to know. And by the time they are practicing it, who will pay for it? The whole community. It will become shameful. Don't forget, the son of each person here. It is very powerful. Each man here, your surname, you are still carrying, isn't it? And you are giving it to your children. And you expect your children to give it to their children. If any of them go to prison, God forbid, that name is going to prison. It's true. That means that one out of how many generations that go to prison is taking the whole generation down to the prison. You see how it works? So you better be very careful and look after your children and protect your surname, not to be wrapped into mud. Please, I urge you, please. And again, do not leave your problem till too late, that nothing can be done about it before you speak out. Call somebody. Please, call somebody before it is too late. We're dealing with one issue now. Everywhere I call, they say, why can't these people call us initially before they are getting to where they are going to sentence them in the next few days? You see that? Please, don't go. Please, I will rather prefer that you are embarrassed initially. You see that? Let's swallow the pride. Let's swallow the embarrassment. Let's call for help before it now turns to the stage where our children will be taken away. Prison, a lot of consequences we face today. Please, I can see that somebody is behind me. Anyway, I just want to thank you for listening. Thank you.
Thank you, Florence. I'll just add one thing that she has not said. She is actually breaking barriers. And only recently, Bexley Heath Council have signed her up. And for anybody who knows Bexley Heath Council, they do not engage with non-whites, let alone engaging with one of our own. So this short presentation that we're laughing and all of that, she's actually having a huge impact in the community. And one thing she said, which we can sort of resonate with, is that do not let the problem or the issue get to the point where it's a point of no return. I say to people, and this is one thing we have in our community, and I don't know how we're going to resolve it, the issue of trust. We are supposed to be, we are so religious, I don't understand it. But when it comes to loving one another, when it comes to protecting one another, we are wicked. We are so wicked, it is unbelievable. If I have a problem, if I know she has all to resolve my problem, I will not go to her. One, pride. Two, as soon as I say to her, the whole world will know. You know what I say to people? I don't have too many friends anyway. I can count my friends in maybe one hand. I don't have too many. Yes, I don't have too many friends. But one thing that I know and I say to people, if I share my problem with you, and you decide to become Ayekoto, what do you call it? And you decide to share it on social media, this is your problem. It is your disgrace. Because people will look at you, yes, they will listen to you, but they will look at you and say to themselves, birds of the same feather. So please, let us engage with one another. Let us talk to one, let us help one another so that we can begin to address issues at the very early stages before they grow into the monsters that we cannot control. Now she's taking my paper. Right. Quickly, the next next person that I will call, like I explained earlier, Mr. Ezekiel works for the British Transport Police. He's a British Transport Police officer, and because of the event on Saturday, he's not here. But we have other members of ABLE, another lady who is a member of ABLE. And sorry, I'll be partial here. My president is here, Kenny Onibokro, the president of Association of British Law Enforcement Officers. She just had a baby, but she just had to come and support us. So please, a round of applause for my president. Thank you. Yeah, I know, it's been partial, but hey. I'm going to call on another member of ABLE, Mrs. Billy Savage, to come and talk to us about ABLE. She's also a magistrate, and she will talk to us about the work of the magistrates and what she sees when she sits in the court when people have brought to her. So, Billy, you have only 15 minutes.
Good afternoon, all.
Good afternoon.
As has been said, I am Billy Savage. I'm a member of ABLE, the Association of British Nigerian Law Enforcement Officers. I'm the Assistant Secretary, MEC's former president, Kenny Onibokro is the current president. What is ABLE? ABLE is a charity organization that was set up in 2004, and our aim is really to promote the positive image of Nigeria. Over the years, as some of you would know, we had a very negative image. ABLE is made up of people that work primarily for the civil service. I work my day job for the Home Office in Ikoyi, and I'm also a magistrate. I can see my members of the Home Office. Some of our members are police officers, the inspector was supposed to present today, and Kenny President works for the police. Other members work for the tax office. So we are made up of members that primarily represent the civil service. And our aim is actually to promote the work of the civil service, to promote the work of Nigeria, to engage with Nigerians, and to actually impact and influence a positive image. That was why the organization was set up. And it was set up to primarily focus initially on immigration, because over the years we had a number of people that were being deported, and as you know, it's not a dignified way to go back to Nigeria, honestly. And what can we do about it? The MEC and I work for immigration, as you know, and we thought the best thing is to promote voluntary returns. People do not like voluntary returns, but voluntary returns has its own benefit, because you can be returned to Nigeria in a dignified way without anybody knowing, and this means of going back privately, and in some aspects, you can get money for it. So that was what ABLE focused on over the years. We have promoted that, and we continue to promote that. So what we're doing now is also trying to promote the other role. As Nelly said, I am a magistrate. I've seen over the years, the impact of what crime and what, well, not just crime, issues that have led people to come to court. I've seen that over the years. I've been a magistrate for 8 years now. The inspector that is supposed to present also has seen issues in our community. And what we want to do now is to tell our community what we can do to help our community. What we want to do is to actually go to the community to engage with them and promote our service to say, if you want to be a magistrate, do you know you can be a magistrate? Do you know you can do this? So we actually deliver presentation, and that's part of what we want to do today, to tell you what we can do. We just deliver presentation on how to be a magistrate, something I'm passionate about. We deliver presentation on your roles and responsibility of living in the UK. Because people do not actually understand that by having definitely, it can be revoked if you commit a crime. So we want to tell the community their roles and responsibility, because at the end of the day, we're here today safeguarding our community. Safeguarding is about protecting our community. And one of the things we want to reduce is the number of Nigerian youth in community care, in social service, in prisons. In the last 5 years, the statistics is there. The increase of our youth, be it because of terrorism, be it because of gun crime, drugs, has gone up. I, for instance, have been to prison my role as a magistrate, and it pains me when I see our children and worries of the other. So what can we do about it? Going back to what has been said education, talking to each other, communicating. Believe me, it's always good to be able to say there's no shame in saying something's happening, let's talk about it. It's about talking and finding solution. What we're doing here today is finding solution to our problem. It is not common to our, it is not only to our own community that has a problem, but what we need to do is to stand up to say, in our community we have a problem, what can we do about it? And that's exactly what we want to do. Now, I'm talking about having seminars. The seminars is usually about an hour seminar. We can't come to your mosque. I am a contact. MC is a contact. And we have dates we can give out. But if you want to contact me directly, I'll give out my contact. But I really, really want to emphasize that we do run awareness session, not just on immigration, voluntary returns. We run awareness session on building magistrate. We run session on preventing people getting into crime. And also, when this happens, what do you know? What do you know to do? Because a lot of people, you see them in court, they don't even have a lawyer. The basic of who to support them, who to support them. They haven't got a friend. They have nothing. They just come in, I don't know what to do. And they're not being appointed to just solicitors. Who are the best? It's time bound. Who are the best? We just going to probably tell them to plead guilty. And it's not in their best interest. So there are support out there, like my sisters, their parents, and there are support out there that we can tap into, that we're entitled to. Now, not having your papers, like my sister's going to talk about, Jennifer's going to talk about, it's not the end of the world. We want, most of us here are professionals in our own day job, but we want professionals to go out to the community, to tell the community what services are out there, so that we can come out to give you the information in terms of, for instance, as a magistrate, if I say, how old do you have to be a magistrate? I'm going to just say, what age is the minimum age for the magistrate? Yes, 18. So that means your son, your daughter, to be a magistrate. And I like to promote that more because in our community people say, oh, I thought I have to be a lawyer. No, you don't have to be a lawyer. You know, minimum age is 18. But it is a lengthy recruitment process and you don't want to prevent it. Crime is having a record in other sectors, but it's a voluntary service. You know, I get paid through your office. This is a lifetime commitment I'm giving because I have to be on my phone all the time. And it's one of these I encourage because we have to be part of the criminal justice system to influence the justice system. Yeah. And that is something I'm always asking. We have to be part of it. Contribute our quota, but it demands a lot of time, commitment, and ethics. You know. When they say you're a magistrate, they don't want to see you behaving in a funny way. And people look at you and say, is that really a magistrate? And I'm not just saying it's cheesy, there's a professional experience that you have to abide by, and even to some extent to your own children and your family. But it can be done because we are professionals and we abide by the rules of the law in this country. So it's something that we can do. So there's no reason to say, actually, it's only the time anyway. But I know by being here today, contribute our quota because most of the time we always have a volunteering for one thing or the other. Being a magistrate requires you to sit at least one day a month. And I sit minimum 13 days in a year. And I'm privileged to work for the civil service, so they give you special leave. So if you work for the civil service, you're entitled to privilege leave. You'll be signed off to go out in there. But you also have to commit your time in the evenings for training and also for meetings. That demands a lot of time management. You know, you have to be able to manage yourself. So as a mother, I work. I have three children, and I work full-time and a magistrate. So I have to manage myself to make sure I'm able to discharge my responsibility. And at the same time, I am required to abide by the rules of the law. I'm at the almost high level as well. So you cannot compromise your judgment, your integrity, at any time you cannot compromise it. But I talk about it to encourage other people. I talk about the great community that it can be done, and you don't have to be a lawyer, and minimum you need is minimum 18 to be healthy, to have the time, and be able to contribute. When you sit as a magistrate, you're sitting in bench of three people. You're ordinary lay people, you always have a clerk who is a trained solicitor to guide you. But there are times I've been in court, and I was surrendering my case. As long as you can be quite pleasing. So why? There was a case in one, and I will share this. It was a case to do with drug on a Saturday. And, you know, they always tell us you take the police court as the eyes. It was a case in court, and I disagree with the two people. with a white man, with a very liberal, no disrespect, a very liberal with the apology. And I actually said, no, I'm not writing bail for this policy. I was so passionate about it. And it was so funny. Anytime you deliberate to come out, the clerk would ask you your reason. And they wanted to know what was the reason for the pitch. And I said, Paris was not giving bail. And was asking the other. And the judge was amazed. I said, yes, I'm not giving bail because I felt the evidence was there. He actually commented me. It was a strong thing to do because, very man, I'm black, Nigerian female, with two strong, bright people. I was listening to my judgment to say, this is my reason. And I was able to give a reason as to why I wasn't giving bail. So, in anything you do, as long as they give a practical, rational reason to say, this is the law. The law says you have to have a reason not to grant bail. And that person made the criteria, and I was able to explain that. So I was able to justify my reason. So we do that in everyday life, rational decision, and that's what you ask people as a magistrate. So I'm going to empower our community to be part of the community, engage more, and think about if possible we have the time to be a magistrate. And bear in mind, as able, I'm representing people today, bear in mind, able is there to support the community. We want to raise the profile further. We don't want to see our children in prison. We don't want to see our family going to prison. And what I want to say is, if you want us to come to your mosque, to come to your church, deliver a presentation on your roles and responsibilities, when people get arrested, there are things they need to be aware of. Search warrant is something I'll touch upon. Search warrant. Police cannot come to your house without a police search warrant. People, they knock on people's door, they put them up on the door. That's against the law. They have to have a search warrant and a reason for them to come and search your house. Those simple equations, those are the things we want to let our people be party to that. You don't panic and people open the door for them. You know. So knowing your rights is important, that by having definitely to remain doesn't mean the next thing you're not going to work with plenty benefits when they told you not to plenty benefits. At the same time, if you're in trouble with police, they come to your door, know your rights. So we're there to support you, we're there to give information. And hopefully, I hope we continue to engage better. Thank you so much. Any questions?
Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you very much for that.
One question?
No, we're not taking questions, unfortunately. She jumped the gun. We'll take questions during the panel sitting. Because we didn't take, yes, I've been impartial, but because I didn't take questions for others, I can't take questions for Abel. Following on nicely into that is Jennifer Obaseki, because the time is pretty gone now. And we still have that session is quite important because we will be setting up the working committee as well. So, Jennifer Obaseki is a solicitor, well known in the community, and one of the reasons why I refer people to her, even when I did my day job as the Home Office National Community Engagement Lead, is because I know that she says it the way it is. She is not in the business, yes, she loves money, but she's not in the business to just take your money. If you go to Jennifer and she tells you, you know what, you're at the end of the road. Trust me, you're at the end of the road. Thank you.
Good afternoon, everyone. Can we all just stand up for a minute, please? I'm going to wake you up. Yes, please stand up. Yes. Can we all have a nice deep breath in? How was your lunch? Good?
Good.
Deep breath in. Do you know what percentage of people don't take away things in any group? They normally say it's 70%.
Yes, yes.
Please, today, we're going to break that rule. All of you please say, I'm a change ambassador.
I'm a change ambassador.
Whether you want it or not, I'm giving it to you today. Please say, I'm a change ambassador.
Change ambassador.
Thank you very much. Please sit down. Right. As you've heard, my name is Jennifer Obaseki. I founded Obaseki Solicitors some 12 years ago, and we've been established in East London for that same amount of time. However, I've been working as a legal professional for over almost 20 years now. It's very important that we see that the law changes, it's dynamic. And today we had an announcement which was what? Theresa May said that I'm going to scale down the Human Rights Act if necessary in order to deal with terrorism. That's just to show you how dynamic, how flexible it is. I believe that the law is robust enough to deal with the situation we have. However, she has announced it today that I am going to make changes. We all know that we have Brexit possibly on our doorsteps unless the Liberal Democrats win the election. We think they're going to have that. So, yes, Brexit is upon us. So that means more legislative changes. It does mean more changes to immigration laws, as you know. There are many, many European nationals here, living here, their dependents here, living here, their relatives that they want to invite here. So I'll start on that premise, that if you're within the community or you have people within the community that you're in contact with that are European nationals or have are dependents of the same, it's important that they get their affairs in order because legislative changes are occurring. So that means they should be having their residence cards. It means their dependents should equally be having their residence cards. And it also means that if they intend on inviting any family members from abroad, each European national is entitled to how many dependents? Three. So if there is that child that they left many years ago, or the daughter of their family member who they are catering for, so far they can show there's been a level of dependency, they should try to do it now before the law changes and it becomes a bit more difficult. But we have been talking today about our community. And the other main concern in our community is that of overstayers. We all know one or two or more. And many people who are in charge of organizations, churches, charities, you'll know that now more than ever, they are leaning upon you for support because it's much more difficult to hide. It's much more difficult to remain incognito because school is there, doctors, ill health is there. The fact that we remain incognito with these things close to our chest means that the proportions of us who are suffering with high blood pressure, mental ill health, which my sister will speak to you about shortly, it means it skyrocketed also. And the unfortunate thing is, again, unfortunately, there are home office delays, and there's even the inability of the individuals to actually meet the criteria to make the application. So it leads to a level of frustration, vulnerability, even criminality. So we all look at those things very, very quickly. Primarily, if you are somebody who actually has leave to remain, but you're finding it difficult to extend your leave to remain, I would ask that you please try to get comprehensive legal advice. Number one, there is the ability to have apply for a fee waiver. That's if you can show that you can economically not meet the cost of the application or your homeless. And showing it means showing evidence. I always say, when people ask, oh, how's it being a lawyer? I always say it's like show and tell. And more so in the UK, you can't just say, oh, I'm homeless and I can't afford to pay my rent. Where's evidence on this? That's the next thing. The person that's assessing or trying to help you needs in order to give you that help. And the one thing that we don't do is we don't document things. We always think that just talking is okay, whereas it's not. So if your sister or your brother or your cousin is saying to you, get out, you've been in this room, we've been helping you for the last 1 year, but we now need our room back. We need to go and live somewhere else. Please, just give me an instant. I can only go and give you the social services or whatever. Very, very important. Secondly, preparedness. You cannot come to a lawyer like me or any other lawyer and think that we can prepare your application A, on credit, and B, within a short space of time. The application forms have grown long. Some of them are up to 60 plus pages long. And again, what did I say? You need to back it up with evidence. So if you're coming, short notice, I've been saving this money, I didn't even have a I'm even short, please, can I quickly put you, my stay is running out next week. You better have your evidence ready, because if I'm going to write to schools, if I'm going to try to compile your documentation, if there's gaps, if I'm going to need to write to HMRC, then I need time to get the letters out and get the response. it's going to come by magic. You have to think, as soon as you've got your needs to remain, about when you're needing to extend and plan that time. Who knows how much it is to actually apply for an extension now? 900 plus your NHS fees, or £1,400 plus. And if that's you, your child, your partner, that's a lot of money. So many of the families, I understand, are under extreme pressure in this time. Extreme pressure. The application fees, in short, is something that I, along with my colleagues here today, appreciate and are talking to the various government officials about. It is something that is crippling our community. Because even when you say you've got your need to remain, like our sister Florence said, daddy's working, mommy's working 24 hours a day. It's because of these costs. Cost of living in London is sky high. By the time you've taken out rent and transport, to now think at the end of the month that you've got some home office fee to pay as well. So please, let us think about being prepared. It really hurts when people come in and they're just a hair away from the deadline and they think that a miracle can be prepared. It's not possible. I have to be sincere with you. And even if we do put it in, we have to then say to the Home Office, documents to follow, so that the caseworker will just reject your application there and then. Because do you know how much it costs to appeal? Yes, there's a cost to appealing as well. The cost of appealing is over £140. So if you think about getting it right in the first place, it is essential. Getting it right in the first place means going to a qualified immigration advisor. Not the one that Rana so-and-so said you should meet by Tesco's or in a cafe. One that actually has legal qualifications, a law degree or an OISC qualified individual. It also means somebody that has insurance. Insurance, why? Because in case their office gets flooded or they go to Nigeria and don't come back, you've got someone to claim for. Or takes your documents from you and then again disappears to Hawaii and doesn't come back. The number of clients that I've seen come like, why did you not put your application in time? My lawyer, he traveled to Nigeria. What do you mean your lawyer traveled? And then, was there nobody else to deal with your application? Apart from having insurance, you have to make sure the person is experienced, fully experienced in that area of law. Not somebody that's just doing it because they've heard. Lots of immigrants are around, but they're desperate. Many are so inexperienced, they put in the wrong applications, give the wrong advice. They think that FLRO is the number one form that they can use for everything. Further needs to remain for that. FLRO. Don't worry, I've done the application. It's on human rights. Hello? So we've heard these things, and again, like Florence said, we're laughing. But the catastrophic consequences that follow, lead to the intervention of social services, lead to people being arrested, as I said, vulnerability, criminality, and worse. So let us, again, look at people, as I've said, who have overstayed, and those are the ones who tend to be the most needy in our community. Right now, the regime is very tough. What did I say?
Tough.
There's the Sahara Desert. Right now. So if you have somebody who hasn't been here close to 20 years and they have no children, close to 20 years, and they're asking you to make or give them money to help support their application, please be aware that you need to ask for one thing. Application based on what? Based on what? The one thing I don't do is I do not give false hope. I always manage a client's expectation. This is the rule. This is what you need to qualify for the rule. If you don't qualify for the rule, this is the likely result. To sit down and say that there's some magic in between, unless there's exceptional circumstances, and the threshold of exceptional circumstances has been moved so high. Whether you have children, that's not an exceptional circumstance. If you are ill, you have AIDS, you are disabled, that's not an exceptional circumstance. summary or the simple way to put it, that is what an exceptional circumstance is. Something that interferes so severely with your human rights, again, all these lawyers that like to throw that word around. The European Convention of Human Rights is not something that is trivial, and the Home Office, again, has made sure that when the case law is being interpreted, and when they're looking at your cases, they fully apply their considerations under the Human Rights Act. Equally, if you have children, they again look at Section 55, the Children Borders Act, and again, give full consideration for children. But the thing is, when you look at children who are over the age of 7, and people again have been wrongly put in applications, thinking that that is something that will keep them, unfortunately, it has been reinforced right the way up to the Supreme Court that a child that is in a family is expected to leave the country with the parents. There will be a period of uncomfortability, definitely. But that child will be encouraged to settle by the parents in the new country or the country of origin, even if that child was born here. So most people that have overstayed, if they have children that are over the age of 7, it is important that they make a decision as to whether they, A, make an application that may or may not be successful, especially if there's no exceptional circumstances, the application is not likely to be successful. If the child has no ill health, no barrier to them reintegrating back home, which is the main test, is there a barrier to this family or this child reintegrating? Then, unfortunately, the application is unlikely to be successful. Again, we have to look at the issue of risks of harm. If there's risks of harm for the individual or the child going back home, for example, if you come from a place where they practice FGM, and you know that you and your two daughters, if you go back home, whether you consent to it or not, somebody's going to grab that child and actually commit FGM on her. You have to then think, do I now say, okay, these children have not even reached 7, but I've been here clandestinely in the UK. Do I make an application for asylum, especially if I cannot meet that application fee? Because asylum is free. All you have to do is you have to line up at the Home Office, or you actually call in and make an appointment. It is that simple. You don't need to give millions or thousands to a lawyer to do it. If you are sincere about what you're saying, then you can make your application to the Home Office for asylum to outline the reasons why, if you are returning to your country, you will come to a serious harm, or you'll be at risk of even worse, harm, serious injury, or death, or you'll be persecuted. So there are also the issues that other people have, they experience delay, maybe they have complaints. One of the things that you must do is you realize that the Home Office have a processing application, usually at the minimum of 6 months. And if it goes beyond that 6 months, number one, if you're claiming asylum, it goes beyond a year, or less than a year, you can ask for permission to work. But if it goes beyond 6 months, just for a normal application for an extension, you can write in to request a complaint. There is now an online checking service. So you can actually check the progress of your application online now. No need to pay somebody, as I said, just to write in or phone in and check. You can also make a complaint to your MP. The MP normally gets a response within 2 weeks. There are other various charities and organizations that you may lean to, especially if you can't afford the application for you. I'll just round up by saying, at our offices, at Obaski Solicitors, we have a free clinic every Friday. And we've been doing that for close to 11 years as well. So you can always send people along to get answers to their queries. We also offer legal aid in family law and housing law, so you'll be able to come along, and if you qualify for legal aid, get help with your matter. So please, please, as I've said, you've promised me today that you're going to be what?
Changed.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Jennifer. I think it is important for us to hear from people who know their onions in terms of when it comes to legal matters. When people like me say it, it's because I've been paid to say so. Or as a staff of the Home Office, that's what people say, oh, that's what you're being paid to do. But when you hear someone who is in the business,
you will pay her anyway. I'm standing here and telling you that we need to be certain of what we're putting in. We need to educate ourselves. When I go around talking, and I say to people, at the end of the day, there is nothing that the lawyers are doing. She will spend the time to look into information. I know of a guy who put his own bundle together, and all he did was get the lawyer to look over it. So let us spend time, let us educate ourselves. I've got a young man here. He's not on the agenda, but because we're talking about safeguarding, and in most times we don't have our young people to actually tell us, because we keep talking about what we think they want, not what they really want. So I will give him 5 minutes to talk to us, because I don't know what he wants to talk to us about. So I'm as blank as you guys are. So I don't even know his name. But he's here. So young man, please.
Help the other children and also help children help themselves. So we've got a lot of ideas on education and stuff that I want to bring over there. But yeah, we need the support of the older generation to help this younger generation move and grow. So
Thank you. You know, if I wasn't going to take anything away today, Mr. Neman, I think you need to be engaging this young man. Told you I don't even know his name.
Ladies and gentlemen, you permit me to breach protocol.
Yeah, I love
it. Or the order of work.
Yes, you permit it.
Simply to reinforce what the gentleman has said. I was in Bradford 2 months ago, and the community in Bradford had a program, and it was actually focused on linking the old generation of Nigerians who were in Bradford in the 1940s, and those others that were born here. So it was a project, to build linkages and sustain, basically, in an effort to sustain Nigerian culture. Those things that we have abandoned over the decades. Now, what this gentleman has said here today, let me buy her word, narrative. It is a fundamental shift in narrative. I do not know of another country where its citizens lambast it, flog it, and banish it.
Thank you.
I tell you that nobody will speak your story more than you.
Thank you.
Nobody will tell your story. Only you can tell your story. If anybody sits and tells you, yeah, this is Britain, I'm Britain, nobody will tell you, nobody will talk about Nigeria for you if you don't speak out, if you don't say it. And if all you say about Nigeria is negative, who will tell the positive part of Nigeria? Some story was going around when Joshua won the world title. When he was caught with marijuana or something, stopped. He said, Nigeria won. And then when he won the championship,
they say the
with very deep sympathy with what had happened in the UK lately, with the terrorist incidents. I kept asking myself the question, this book is a British Pakistani bomb. You linked countries based on negativity.
Exactly.
We have to talk about something positive.
Yeah.
But beyond talking positive,
we act.
These guys are saying they are going to act. Nigeria will not be Britain if we don't make it Britain. When you analyze Nigeria, you are analyzing Lagos, and I'm telling you here about professors, doctors, educated men, supposedly. When they are analyzing Nigeria, they are analyzing forex, price of crude oil, they are discussing rail or stuff like that. Let me tell you, you are only discussing with less than 10% of Nigerians. 90% of Nigerians are in the hinterland.
Thank you.
Right deep down there, and these issues are not relevant to them.
Thank you.
The issues that are relevant to them are the issues of being alive. Basic healthcare.
Yes.
You don't have the lack of what you can do because it is about your will to do so. So you do not sit down. They are not committed to poverty and suffering, and you are committed to comfort. Your duty is to pay back.
Yes.
They were talking about brain. We should be talking about brain gain now. That's what you're talking about now. That's what the young man is talking about. This is a young man telling you that he's bought something from here. He was born here. He has no business going back because of what. But he's telling you that he's going to go back.
Yep.
And be back. Please, let us look at this. Let us
that is passion. And you know what? I am your number one country. I shall collect your number. Honestly, young people like this, we need them. Like I said, I've got a 19-year-old and a 17-year-old boys. I need them to be speaking to someone like this. We all need our children. He went to Nigeria the first time.
Exactly.
And he's in love
with the kids.
It was those of us that grew up and jumped all the water there. All of a sudden, Nigeria has become a no-go area. God help us. Moving on swiftly, I'd like to call on the CEO of the news organization, that is Facebook, she will be talking to us about mental health. Mental health, as I said at the beginning of this meeting, is something that we need to start talking about. As a community, we do not talk about it. I am a first aid. Mental aid first aider, which is something that is new. And also, my MP was also given, or what's the word, achieved because of my contribution to the civil service as a result of my work, part of my work. As of 2015, every civil servant in the United Kingdom now has access to free mental health service. That was one of the reasons that I got my MBE on. So it is something that I am very, very passionate about. It is something that we need to start talking about. It is something that we need to inform and educate ourselves about. So, Lade, section, because I know that when Nigerians hear about the Nigerian High Commission, the only thing that comes to our head is immigration. We forget that that is not the only thing they do. They do other things, but it looks like immigration, our passports, we're applying for visa, anything that has to do with immigration is what comes to mind. So I will give Mrs. Ngeri about a minute to just educate us, because I can tell you, I work very closely with them. There's so many things that we are not alluded to, and we need to understand where they are coming from. I have not told them for them.
Good afternoon. I'd just like to continue your program that I've been following. I just really want to make one comment and to say that Ego and the Nigerian Commission, we the Nigerian Commission, have been doing quite a lot of work on standard language. Let them help build Nigeria and turn around Nigeria.
expand a little what minutes of what you said. In my role as the National Committee Engagement Lead for the Home Office, I am the interface between the Nigerian Committee and the Home Office. And what has been happening over the years is that a lot of people want to go home. They really, really want to go home. But yes, the Home Office has some funding, but they don't all qualify. So the one that actually kicked this off was a 68-year-old Nigerian who had come to the United Kingdom in 2011. And obviously all the promises he had and he decided, you know what, I want to go back home. He was sleeping on the streets, he had diabetic, he couldn't access, he was too fearful to go to the hospital. So I was able to walk with my colleagues in the Home Office. Obviously we have a system where we can buy him a ticket, but he didn't qualify for funding. So what I did was I put on my community hat on, and I sent out a global to my friends on WhatsApp. The intention was only to raise between 500 and £1,000. But guess what? In 3 days, we raised £1,725. And what we then did was, because we know that a lot of people are in that pool, we then gave £1,000 because it was because of him that we got that money. And a lot of people have said to me, you know what, we want to be part of it. So please, my plates are full and running over. I need people to come on board and take this project and sort of grow with it. I was still part of it. And after this man had gone, like she said, there was one day a girl, she came here, tried everything to stay, got pregnant in the process, she lost the baby. And she just brought her back to Beckett House and said, I want to go home to play. Yes, it's not funny. You need to, when you see that she's in a pathetic situation, she had been abused and everything. Of course, my colleague called us at the beginning. Straight away, she got me ETC. And part of the money that was left is what we're now leaving out. But what I want to do is set up a community account. I need people to come on board. I'm looking at somebody in particular who is very, very has been helpful. Jamil is very good. To come up, set this thing up properly where people can donate from time to time. But this will come to our attention. We then give them £100 and £200. Please. This is part of safeguarding our community. This is part of what makes me proud to be a Nigerian. Because as a Nigerian, we're always looking out for one another. Okay? Yes. So after the meeting, if you're interested, just come and speak to me. So quickly, like I said, she will be talking to us about mental health. She will focus on introducing the news, and then the doctor will talk about it from a medical angle. Thank you very much.
Good afternoon. I said the good afternoon the second time was because sometimes when you're the last speaker, Jennifer rightly said earlier, a lot of people who go to events like this, 70% don't take away anything because you've heard so much. So I'm going to ask you to do an exercise. Is that okay? So the thing you're going to take away from here, just remember the lady that bothered you. Can you please stand up in your face? Remember the lady and Kalita, the second lady that bothered me that asked us to stand up. Can we all stand up? Apart from the old, the elderly,
in that case.
Okay. So can we just lift up this hand? The right hand. Okay? And I'm going to go back to what my lady did, the exercise she did earlier. Did you all know about Bob the Builder?
Yes.
For those of us who don't.
Yes.
So we're going to sing the song, Bob the Builder.
Yes, we can. Bob the Builder. Yes, we do.
Please go ahead.
Yes, we can. Bob the Builder. Can we do it?
Yes,
we
can.
Yes, we
can.
Yes, we can. I was saying to myself, a lot of these very great speakers that have spoken before me, you know, people still be able to absorb anything that we say, that I'm going to say, but of course I think we will, because because it's a fact that we've all left our various jobs. I had to take annual leave today. And I'm sure a lot of you are taking time off work today to care. And that's because you're passionate about something. The title of the conference today is Safeguarding the Nigerian Community. Mm-hmm. About 3-4 months ago, Yemisi and I, and Jennifer, and Yemi Ebunu, and Lawrence came together because we realized that there was a thread around the various issues that we're all talking about. I'm someone who's very passionate about mental health, and you hear me talk about mental health later. The issues, rising issues every day around safeguarding with our young people. There are rising issues every day around safeguarding with adults. There are issues as well with our young people. Gun, knife, gangs, crime, growing issue. And there is a, can I use the word grower issue? No, I can't. I'm a graduate of English, I know I can't. But there is a more major issue around mental health issues in our community. And this is because it's something that I realized that for a very long time, Africans, as we are Nigerians, there's some topics you don't like to talk about. We keep it secret, we keep it under the lid. You know, you don't like to talk about issues going around your children. Whether your child has just slapped you, you don't like to talk about it. You keep quiet. Whether your husband has just beaten you, or your wife has just slapped you at home, we keep quiet. Domestic abuse and mental health issues are issues that we don't like to talk about. And also our finance. I'll just add our finance as well. We all like to keep quiet and pretend about our finance. Even when you can't afford it, you know, you go ahead and ask because you want to impress the Mr. Ola and Mr. Chike and Mr. Bala, whatever you want to call it. We all just want to go out to impress and to cover our issues. There is an adage in my language that says that when your young is ripe not to eat, you cover it. We have an adage as well that says that, you know what, you don't string your dirty linens outside. You bring it inside, you don't put it outside. Unfortunately, a lot of these adages that we have has constrained and conditioned our mentality and the way we think. All around the various spheres of our life, especially around mental health issues. Whether we like it or not, the issues are staring and glaring in our face daily, daily, daily. The pressures are mounting. And like I was sharing with my sister earlier when she was here, Sister Brinkis, I was sharing with her, tomorrow will decide a lot of this United Kingdom, in the United Kingdom, for a lot of us. Brexit is already determining a lot of things. Well, how we exit Brexit will affect a lot of things. It's going to affect you and I. Mm-hmm. And there are growing implications around those things. And one of it is the fact that our jobs will be affected. Our children will be affected. The environment will be affected. Police will be affected. Every single sphere of our life will be affected. Whatever happens tomorrow. And of course, there is implication around our mind, our hearts. There's implication about how can we absorb and how can we cope with what's going to happen after Brexit. How are we going to cope? It's one thing that I know a lot of us that think about. We get scared. I get scared sometimes. But let me just quickly introduce you to me. My name is Ladi Olubeli, and I am the CEO. I like to call myself the convener, actually, the facilitator, the convener of the news organization. The News Organization was an organization that I started 2 years ago alongside with some faithful people who believed along with me in some of what I had been doing before 2 years ago when the organization was registered. And what I had been doing there was actually because I realized, I saw glaring and I saw statistics that scared me day by day in our community. I saw the fact that there was an extremely high number, a disproportionate high number of black people in the mental health sector in United Kingdom. I used to go to the wards. I used to go to a particular hospital. I wouldn't mention the name now. And each time I walked on that ward, I saw a very high number of black people. And it wasn't just the fact that those people were black. I saw a higher number of Nigerians who were there. I move around in our community a lot. And I know that one of the things that I do, my own secret little way, is that I'm a people
watcher. I'm a very shy person. A lot of people don't believe I'm a shy person. I'm a very shy person. One of all I do is that when we're in your community or when we're in settings like this, I like to watch people. I like to watch the way people react, the way people behave. Not because I'm doing anything, but just because, you know, it's just a passion, something that I like to do. And I realize that there are a lot of people, a lot of Nigerians who have undiagnosed mental health issues. We talked earlier about our young people, and I like what Paul said earlier. And that's the fact that we're having a higher number of our young people who are involved in gangs and who are involved in crime. Unfortunately, a lot of this, I don't have the statistics, I'm not a clinician. Unfortunately, from what I perceive and from my interaction with a lot of these young people, they have undiagnosed mental health issues. They're carrying around with them a lot of things, a lot of issues. And the reason why people are not stepping in early is mainly because we have a higher level of stigma in our community around talking about mental health issues. We don't want to talk about it. We believe it's something that we should keep quiet. But fortunately for us, in the last about a year and a half ago, for example, one of the good things she's done is that when she came in, one of the first things she said at her inauguration, or whether I think about a week after, was that she was going to focus on mental health. She said that, well, I haven't seen, to be very honest with you. I haven't seen. But one good thing that I know in the last 6 months that has come up is a lot of the high profile celebrities who've seen, who've been talking about mental health issues in our community. They're helping us to realize that these are issues that we need to break the barriers around. People need to start talking about it. So part of what we do in news is we organize conferences, we organize seminars, we go to community events like this. Of course, I have only 5 minutes. I think I spent about 3 minutes out of that. I spent about 3 minutes out of that. So we come to events like this to talk specifically about the barriers that we have and the need for us to remove those barriers, to encourage what I call early intervention, to encourage what I call prevention. We can prevent a lot of the mental health breakdown that happens if there's early intervention as well. To also raise awareness about what are the signs to look out for. And that is why collaborating people I work with clinicians like Dr. Ajayi, who's going to be talking earlier, and we'll be talking about engaging with the Nigerian community from the psychiatric point of view. Fortunately, the first seminar we had, Dr. Ajayi was one of the speakers there. Yeah, I think so. The second conference, Dr. Ajayi was there. So what we do is we organize what I call an open mic session. For those who were at our last open mic session, you would attest to the fact that it was very, very heart-wrenching. The fact that people, for the first time, for me, I think it's the first time in a Nigerian community, that professionals could talk and own up issues around mental health issues they were going through. So Mr. Pagoto is there. Thank you for coming the last time. You would attest. And of course, my only MP friend. I've called her my only MP friend. Lemisi was there as well. She would attest to how passionate that environment was. And that just shows me that people are ready to break the barrier because we're suffering. A lot of us put on the merry hair, the makeup and all of that. We make ourselves look good. But we know that in our heart of our heart, there are issues going on. But the minute you wear your tie, you don't go to the barber, you do all these ties and all of that. But you know that there are issues going on. What we say at the nurses, and that's why you have this, it's about the news about your mind. News is actually a Greek word, meaning mind. The truth is, if your mind is impaired, there's very little you can do with your body or your spirit. You can go to your mosque or you can go to your church as much as you can. If your mind is impaired, your mind cannot absorb, your spirit or your body will not be able to absorb anything. The news is very, very important. Our minds are very, very important. And there's a need for us to know how to protect it. It's not what we can talk about today, but we organize seminars to do that. For example, one of the things we talked about on Facebook is that the effect of the post-trauma that people will be having just based on the last recent terrorist attack we've had. Whether you like it or not, you've been affected. I'm really affected. I get on the bus these days and I'm looking around for the person who's carrying a heavy rucksack. And I move away. Actually, on Monday, I got down from the carriage I was in, and I had to go to another carriage because there was a guy who was very suspicious to me. Well, because he's very suspicious. There are attendance ripple effects of issues like this. Our plan not just about looking at the Black, Asian, and minority ethnic communities here in the UK. We actually intend to go into Africa. And I'd like to recognize the presence of Mrs. Emoka. She's from Sierra Leone. She works very closely with the Minister of Youth and Empowerment in Sierra Leone. And we, alongside the African Security Forum, we're going to Sierra Leone by the grace of God later this year. There is a lot of work to be done. So it's not just about us talking about what we can do in our community. And like the young man said, it's about being able to take that back to where we're coming from.
Yes.
We have lots of issues here, we have skills here, but we need to take that back. Because whether you like it or not, there is an effect of what I call the transgenerational carryover of issues. So for example, those who witnessed civil war in Liberia, in Sierra Leone, the effect is there. That's what we're talking about with Mrs. Kelokai and the government of Sierra Leone. The effect is not the young people. There are major problems now in Sierra Leone with their young people because their emotional issues have not been dealt with. Yes, they built the houses, they rebuilt the streets, they rebuilt the roads, but the people are suffering. There's still a panic attack. A lot of the young people are into gangs, they're into drugs. Issues have not been attended to. And that is what the news is about. The news is about effecting changes, raising awareness about mental health issues, impossible influencing policies. And I'm very grateful that we're working with some local authorities now. We work with Brent local authority at the moment, raising awareness about talking therapies. And it's the fact that a lot of people think that, you know what, I don't want to talk to a psychiatrist. Yes, don't talk to a psychiatrist. You can talk to psychotherapists. We do a lot of work in the community. I'll be more than happy to come to any event that you hold to talk more. Because I think I spent about 10 minutes. I'm going to introduce Dr. Ajayi to you very quickly. He's a consultant psychiatrist who is very, very passionate about making an impact in our community. Please give him a round of applause.
Good afternoon, everyone. It's nice to be here this afternoon. Like I said, my name is Ajayi. I'm a medical psychiatrist and I work in the Southeast. I work in Kent. I think one of the reasons why I'm pleased to be here this afternoon is because I believe that indeed events like this can make a change. Events like this do add up and they can change people's lives, they can change outcomes for people. One story that comes to mind for me was in 2001, I just started my career in psychiatry at the time. It was a Monday morning, I had arrived at work and usually we take a handover from those who had been on the night before. And I was told, oh, we've admitted a lady who is extremely unwell. She's a Black lady, and since she arrived here 2 days ago, she hasn't had anything to eat. She hasn't interacted with anyone. She's just been pacing up and down the corridor. And so I was asked that could I stay here. So that was priority. And in my mind, I was bracing up to see somebody who was extremely unwell, somebody who really needed urgent psychiatric attention. So I go into our room, and as soon as I enter the room, our face lights up. So the first thing I'm thinking is, okay, it's not what I'm expecting to see. She then tells me, I then introduce myself. As soon as I introduce myself, she immediately picks up that I'm in Nigeria. She immediately picks up that I come from the same part of Nigeria as she's from. That's why I'm facing the lights off. And she says, doctor, there's no reason why I need to be here. She says, there's nothing wrong with me. And we then sat down together and we tried to unpack her story. Indeed, it turned out that the reason why she got sectioned was because she had a son. She'd been lighting candles because she was told from church that she needed to light candles. Our neighbors had seen that. They reported it, and she was arrested, and eventually they thought she had mental difficulties. And then she'd gone and told at the assessment, she said, my heart has now been taken away. Because our son was the only child she had, that was the only possession she knew. Now, that was a gripping story. We then spoke together. I said, look, I don't think there's anything wrong with you. I can see that it's nothing wrong. But if you present yourself the way you presented yourself to me now, nobody's going to believe you. You know the way Africans did. We gesticulate with our hands, we talk with our body. That's going to come across wrong. And so eventually she got discharged on that day because I went to the wardrobe and I told my boss, I said, I don't really think there's anything wrong with this woman. I understand her culture, I understand where she's coming from, I understand all these things. The good news is mental services have moved on a great deal from that place. That was 16 years ago. Now we provide a culturally appropriate service. That's a service that is tailored to somebody's culture and their background. And I think that that's something to be excited about. Because really, I think one of the issues with safeguarding that community, one of the reasons why people fall prey is because of the myth that we believe. The things that are not true that we hold also tenaciously onto. One of them is that if people seek mental support, that their children will be taken away. The reality is that most children are not taken away. The reality is that, in fact, if people ask for help, it's less likely for their children to be taken into care. But these are the messages that we need to be giving to people in our community. The reality is that, indeed, mental problems is a big issue in the African community in the UK. The figures don't sound good. If somebody is an African and they are young and they are second generation Africans, in the UK, they are 18 times less more likely to be admitted to the psychiatric hospital than the general population. That's not good news for the second generation. You would have expected that the people who came to UK as first, that should be affected, but they are not. Because it's those children who come at a time where it's very difficult for them to adapt to the bullying, to adapt to the unemployment, to adapt to the poverty that their parents have to deal with, to adapt to all those challenges. Those are the people who at a very young age are having to deal with that. And then what happens, because they are not able to cope, sometimes they turn into gang crime, sometimes they turn into drugs and alcohol abuse. And the result is that as a very young person, their young brains are polluted, and there's already, the young brain then created, is already adapted and given it's already made to be predisposed to mental illness. So it's only a matter of time when they become young adults, they begin to manifest these symptoms. My main message to us this afternoon is really about engagement with mental services. I've spoken about the fact that people believe that their children will be taken away, and that's wrong. The other thing that people believe is that if they engage with mental services, they are going to be locked up. That's also not true. The reality is that the people who don't engage with services are the ones who are more likely to be locked up. And the reason why they are more likely to be locked up, and I wouldn't even use the word locked up, they are the ones who are more likely to be sectioned, to be detained, to be kept in hospital for a short period until they get well, to be able to be discharged. Now, the challenge with that is when people stay and allow things to get out of control before they engage with services, what usually happens is, eventually they become so unwell that there needs to be an intervention. People like myself are then forced to say, we are sorry, you are at a point in which you can't take decisions by yourself. We need to step in and take decisions for you. And because we are duty bound to do that, if a psychiatrist, for instance, attends to somebody who needs to be in hospital and they don't have the capacity to make that decision, and you leave them and anything happens to them, you are liable. So these are the sort of things that it's very important for us to be carrying to our communities. So it's not true that people get locked up. It's usually a very last resort. And the reality is that as much as possible, mental services are working towards keeping people in their homes. That's why we have the home treatment team, for instance. The home treatment team works to try and keep people inside of their homes whilst they are receiving treatment. The other thing that our people also believe is that when people take psychiatric medication, that they become zombies. They'll say, oh, they don't want to take medication because they don't want to become zombies. That is also not true. Research is now showing that more every day, every year, we have new sets of medicines that help the mind that are being released. So research is going on every day, every minute. Research is going on to make sure that those tablets are more suitable for people, and there are several of them that people can choose from. And just like Ade said as well, that it's not just about medication. Sometimes talking therapy helps. So there are lots of options that are available. There are social interventions that are available. There are benefit options that are available. It's just to really support people to try and deal with their stress and to help them to overcome the challenges. Now, I don't think it's any news to us. We all know that mental health problems are a challenge for the African community in the UK. Everybody knows that. There's a lot of research showing it. But I think we should move on from there. I think we should be talking about how to deal with these things. We should be talking about how to really move forward. And I really value the work that people like the news are doing, because there's a lot of work that goes into that. And I do feel that as a community, as the Nigerian community or the African community in the UK, we have enough to change this. We have enough psychiatrists, we have enough on social workers, we have enough nurses, we have enough professional therapists. So we can really turn this around. But it comes with engaging the right people. I don't know how many times I've been called, maybe pastor colleagues have called me, or friends have called me, and they've said, we have a particular situation. Somebody is unwell, what can you do? And I'll gladly go to their homes, see those patients on their behalf and make recommendations. Maybe you need to go to the GP. And just those time interventions can actually turn things around. Sometimes people have been saved from going to hospital. Sometimes people have been encouraged to go into hospital voluntarily rather than be forced into hospital. But all of those things matter. All of those things count. So really, my message to us this afternoon is that mental services are there for everything. And I do think that we do help. I think not engaging with services at a very timely period usually ends up in more complications. People get detained in hospital, and when they get detained in hospital, it's a very nasty experience for them. And so they become biased about the service, and so they are more less likely to engage. And so there's a revolving door in a situation in which every time they come into hospital, it's because they are forced back into hospital. So really, the message here is that in the community, among the African community, among the Nigerian community in the UK, we have enough resources within ourselves. And what I usually encourage is that I think we need to be engaging more. If somebody gets admitted into hospital, they have a neighbor who knows about mental, let them support them, attend their ward rounds with them, attend their audition clinic with them. The reality is that psychiatrists are willing to engage with the community. There are psychiatrists who don't understand the language of our culture, but they are very keen on engaging with people who understand the language of the culture so that they can provide the culturally appropriate service. So really, what we need to be doing is to be engaging. There's so much to be done. I think, for instance, the Royal College of Psychiatrists, for instance, would like some people who are seated here today to be involved in some of their policy making. It's really about trying to break those barriers. It's really about representing our own people. It's about representing what we stand for. The final thing I want to say is that I think we need to concentrate on the target at risk group. And when I talk about the target at risk group, there's a particular group that are always the target at risk group, and those are new immigrants. People who come to the UK newly. I would like to see a situation in which there is a gathering like this that's organized for people, it's free. People who have just newly immigrated to UK can come and attend and get information about their finances, about mental health, about engaging with GPs, about what their rights are. You see, cushioning, when I say cushioning, that's softening the landing of people coming from Nigeria and make a world of difference. research that immigration, that people who need to immigrate are very high risk of mental health problems. In fact, we also do know that people who newly immigrated in the last 3 years or so are also at high risk of suicide. So really, my final message is that we've got enough within us to make it happen, and we can all be catalysts of change.
Thank you. As a matter of fact, I think I will take you on that. One of the things that I'm trying to put in place, especially in the home office, is one of the things we're looking to implement as part of ensuring that when people come to the UK, they are well equipped in terms of information, is to get, because it's difficult to get up when they get here. One of the things that I'm looking to introduce at the British High Commission in Nigeria is once you get your, before you get your visa, if they are sure that they're going to leave you, they invite you to like half a day session where they tell you about the typical life of a British person. They tell you how much we pay as tax. They tell you we pay for everything apart from the air that we live in. They tell you, and they give you that information so that when you're coming here, whatever story that you have been told by your family, you can then compare both. Because what has happened in so many cases, especially those that have come as highly skilled, you can imagine a bank manager leaving his well-paid job and coming to the UK to become a security guard. And then what would happen is he would bring his whole family. Meanwhile, the friend, and this is why I say we're wicked, the friend that is here that is promising heaven and earth, because the poor guy is 6,000 miles away. As soon as the reality hits you in the face, your three-bedroom house, there's leaving the lights on, running the water as if they don't pay the bill. That is when the friction starts. You kick them out of the house. The man does not have a job. He's given up his job in Nigeria. There's nowhere to go to. What then happens? They become stuck. The reverse will say, why do you jail or you jail? Why? You cannot go to the front, you cannot go to the back. And we have to stop this. So what I feel strongly that we need to tackle that up. When people attend events like that, where this is debatable on unemployment for people who have, what do you call it? This is the number of people that sleep on the streets. This is the number of children that run away from home. Like all of that, just so that all these silly stories that we have been selling to people is a way and we have the reality right in front of us. Now, we need to go because I'm very, very conscious of time. We need to go straight into the panel discussion and forming the working committee. Like I said, this is not like any other event we've been having. This one is to key in into various government departments so that we can begin to impact on policy formulation. So I will call on all the people that have opportunity. Paul has gone, but if anybody has any questions that has to do with Paul's role in MOPAC, that is the Mayor's Office of Police and Crime, what he's looking at doing is looking at how to tackle the issue of gun, knife crime, especially in our community. If anybody has any questions around that, you can email it to me and I'll pass it on to him. Obviously, I will drive him into this conversation, you'll trust me. So, can I have Dr. Balagi on the table? Can I have Saffron? Now, there's a key person in Saffron before we all get started that we have not introduced. Where's Yemi? Are you confused? Dr. Ahmed? Yeah. Can I have you on the table for the panel of the Board of Hope? Stand up. Quick. Can you come and introduce the head of somebody?
very important. And someone who we cannot. Before she smacks my head, please let's welcome Miss Falashade Elizabeth Ajayi. She's the head of service for Sam in the UK.
Good afternoon. ladies and gentlemen. I must commend the organization to IBO, and the event is very encouraging. My question, my name is Sojit Lumoka. I'm an engineer, a civil engineer, so I'm not coming from any immigration program. Over the years, I have observed, particularly to do with Nigerian children in schools, there have been, we know it's rampant in every community, bullying. My question is about bullying. How has the Nigerian community or an organization like IBO been able to create an awareness of the support system you currently have to help most of these children within UK? And it would be nice to have some kind of organized event to take this to schools, most of the schools where Nigerian children are registered in within UK. It will help them in the long run, and it will help the Nigerian community safeguarding the interests of our children. Thank you.
Thank you. Okay, let's take those first three questions. The first one was about trafficking, which I can actually take, but I'll let one of you take it. The second one.
Sorry. In relation to trafficking, can I say that we have a group here that actually have a lot of information, and they also have one of these little leaflets that you can, if you're working in the community, it's important to know where to get information from. So apart from the .gov website, Afrupa actually have a lot of these little cards that give a lot of information in relation to domestic slavery, how to report it, also how you can express your concerns. There's a free number there that you can call, and there's just little bits of information there, enough to, let's say if you're in a community, as a community leader, cascade into the community. We said today that we are a catalyst for change, so it's very important that we take away what we gain here and cascade it. So number one, the .gov website. Number two, Afrupa is an organization that's there. And the one thing that you asked, sir, which is how do we tell people that helping people may not necessarily be help? Because it's part of our culture, historically going back centuries, to send somebody on into the family or on to extended relatives for training, it will take time. But it starts with us today, outlining that number one, if your child is being taken from you in your hometown to go elsewhere, then you should know where they're going. You should know what they're going to. Not every promise for a job overseas is actually a job. Mm-hmm. Check out the company. And most recently, I've been sent videos of men being led astray in Saudi Arabia, all being promised jobs. And they get there, and there's thousands and no job. And you can imagine, whatever agent has taken 500, even if it was 50 pounds from them, they've made a mint. Apart from that, we all know about sexual servitude, many girls being tricked into domestic jobs, studying, etc., etc., and being pushed into forced labour. But we also have to look in the UK. The one thing that we even overlook is people who are homeless here, people whose parents have no recourse to public funds and living in accommodation is tight. Oh, there's a job for her in Manchester. Send it up. There's a job for her in Bradford. Oh, I have a farming job down there in the South Coast. Just come. And there's no job. So trafficking can even happen here. So trafficking is where somebody is moved, usually human being, even disabled people are sometimes moved and forced to beg. And their proceeds that they make every day taken. Romanians and Eastern Europeans are known or have a high population that actually do that. But it can happen anywhere, not just internationally, but actually within the UK, which is very sad. And it's all about information and education in order to try and prevent it. As much as it's part of our culture, we have to make our elders back home aware that all promises are not true, not always true, that they must go into research.
Jennifer, sorry, because of the time, can we get the response to, is that still on?
So quickly, the point you said about people
people being in the UK. In the UK, there's also private fostering, which can be done. So you can adopt a child, and the government's aware. But the thing is that that child basically has to get status, which I'm glad that you mentioned actually, they can bring a dependent, and you can get that child into school. That way, the social services get involved, making sure your child has.
Let's add to that, NSPCC as well. They do a lot of work around trafficking, because I work for NSPCC, and we see a huge number of Nigerian children being brought from Nigeria to this country to come and do sex and slavery. So we need to break the silence. And some of the people that bring them here, we might know them, we might not know them, but if we see anything, we need to open the cloth now on the face of the devil. And break the silence, because it cannot continue like that. We have to break that silence. We have to talk. Not everything is about church. Not everything is about mosque. Not everything. Everything is about prayer and about God. But at the same time, when we see something that is not right, we need to stop it. Some of us grew up in a household where there was a maid, but I cannot remember where our maid washed my clothes, like you said earlier on. But some children these days, what they see their parents were doing when they were growing up, they now become an adult and they're doing the same thing. So we need to break that silence. We need to work together. By the safeguarding issue, they suffer. If you don't have this leaflet, please get hold of one. Safeguarding all Nigerian children in this country now. Asian community, they have their own safeguarding community. We want to build our own and we can do it. Please call us. We will be there. In times of safeguarding issue, any safeguarding issue, call us. We will be there to support that family to get through it. We're in it together like that.
Okay, we need to move on quickly. Have we answered the three questions?
No.
Which
no.
one? Okay,
Abel,
can you take that quickly? Just, quickly, please.
The issue about the bullying. I think, am I right? We're talking about the bullying question. In terms of the bullying question, I think what we can do is to organize awareness session. I do a presentation on youth development. And as part of that, I talk about harassment and bullying. Some of the issue we have is exactly what we talked about. We don't talk within our community. We think it's a taboo to talk about what's happening in our family. I'm happy to organize an event where we can actually get our community together, especially the youth. I think what we need more is, when we organize such events, is to get the youth together and actually start talking about the issues that affect them. So Abel is happy to lead on that, and anybody that wants to collaborate with us can do that. So, something that we can do.
Okay, thank you. And then the other one was about supporting vulnerable youth, like people with disability. I think somebody, maybe World of Hope or the doctor, should take that.
When it comes to the, I think you mentioned autistic spectrum. The issue is that we in our community, how do we see these children? That is number one thing. That is my concern. Because family that give birth to a child like that and deny, to love that child for who or who she is, we have problems. So if we, first of all, we will maintain ourselves as parents to know that any child that will give birth to, it's a gift, regardless of anything. So from there, we'll be able to have passion to seek for help, then. We look around us, every borough, they have either in within the council or community organizations that they are working to support the family with children with autistic. But the problem is that if they put on event, how many Nigerian family will go with their children? I think we need to first of all educate ourselves. How do we see our children? If our children have ADHD, do we let ourselves realize that yes, this child needs support, this is reality? Then you can now begin to bring your faith into it. Thank you.
Thank you. Hi, good afternoon, everyone. My name is Cheryl Phoenix, and I actually run, hi, Jennifer. I run an organization called the Black Child Agenda,
And what we did is we tackled the schools to prison pipeline, i.e. we have a lot of issues, like was mentioned, bullying. Racial discrimination goes on a lot in schools with our young people. The trauma of what they go through, some of our children are being isolated, locked in rooms and left there for weeks at a time, not given lunch, told to start school at a different time to everybody else. This has a direct impact on what's going on with regards to safeguarding. There's a lot of illegal practices going on in the education system, and part of my, well, my organisation, we go out, last year we dealt with over 1,000 parents and young people who were illegally excluded from school. Now I say that to say this, one thing I have found within the Nigerian, my late husband, I'm not Nigerian by birth myself, maybe somewhere in my distant somewhere, but I came via the Caribbean. My late husband was a Nigerian, and one thing that we did find, and we have found, and I've seen myself, is that the increase in Nigerian children who are being excluded from school. Now, once upon a time, I'll say this to you guys are sending your children back home to be educated. Why are you leaving them here to be miseducated in this country? Why are they here in this country? The education system in Nigeria is better than here, and the abuse that our sons in particular are going through, and the disproportionate numbers of them in the mental health institutions, and also the prison systems, is a problem. So rather than looking at this system to actually fix our problems, we have a whole continent to look at, but yet we're begging and borrowing from the UK, the tiny islands, who have done us no favours yet, and will never do us any favours. So that's all I have to say. It wasn't really a question, but we're here as an organisation. So if you want to tap into us, our resources, we have a legal team, we also have people that deal with our mental health, etc., etc. We're there, and my phone doesn't stop ringing daily, and the increase in Nigerian families is a problem.
We'll take our details and share it with everyone.
Please, okay? can I just
do three.
I don't want anybody to go out of this room with a wrong impression. Not all parents that can take their children back to their family. Let's get it right, please. I give back to my child a responsibility. If I decide to be there, I will deal with the issue, I will support my child, whatever it takes. If it was the last drop of my blood, I should do it. Thank
you. That's fine. It may work for some, it may not work for, but you need to understand if it is something that will work for you. That is the message here.
Hello, my name is Oyewale Owuru, and I want to say thank you, one, for everyone that's come, for all your organizations and the work they've done, especially Saffron with Safeguard a Nigerian Child. But I also want to say, when you have an issue with maybe a friend or someone in university or so that's in school and they want to pursue something that's not as academic, that, you know, the engineer, doctor, lawyer, but maybe their parents are holding them back and not letting them. I've had, you know, a close case with one of my own friends that would have done a shoot for GQ, but his parents wouldn't let him go to Turkey for one day. And I just wanted to know, what would you do in these situations to help them? The second thing I wanted to say as well is that, what can young people do to, you know, help, as in meet in the middle with your organizations and the actual people that need the help?
Okay, thank you.
My name is Felicia Cotton. Talking about vulnerability, we talked about the youth. We didn't talk too much on the elderly.
Exactly.
And if you look at the children, we also talk about our children, and we're going to problems and all. I want you to see that it starts from even the school. You know, when they go to school, the racism starts, so we don't know how it was inculcated into the other color. Because you will see, when they see the black and maybe he wants to be friendly with them, the way they are repulsive, you know, can be something that will stick into the child and can grow up with it. And I see us talking about Nigeria, even if we can watch Nigeria play, the youths, I mean, they will still go back into the society. Yes. So how do we bring the other African countries together for something meaningful, or the work to the same as well?
Thank you.
Now, because you would have to bear with me, because, I mean, some people got here for like 10, 30
30 on the dot, and we're still here. We thought we were going to finish up together. She was one of the people that got here. So I have to. She got it.
Thank you very much. I must congratulate the panel on all those who organized this event. I'm grateful to God that the young ones are waking up now. We are too old to take the role. Seeing you making this impact, I'm really, really, really happy about you.
Between the ages of 20, 18 to 35. to actually, and I will be key, I will really, really want one young person to be on this committee. Now,
I just want to say a big round of applause for all the people on the panel for what the work you've done so far and what you're obviously going ahead doing going forward. I've always been passionate about Nigeria. I grew up here.
Sorry,
my name is Susan Falola, and I came here when I was 2.5 years old, and I'm 30 years old now, and I've never ever lost my heritage. Never since I grew up here, and I love it here. So basically, I went in 2009 to Nigeria. So the question is, basically, I wanted to know what you're doing with particularly men, because I believe there's a lot of work being done around women, but I think men need work as well. So basically, what I mean in regards to, I mean, men themselves need to know that they are empowered in the household. So they need to take responsibility of their household, as in terms of their wife, in terms of their partner and their children, because I feel that the responsibility in our African community lies with the woman, and that needs to really be changed, because, you know, reality stands, women do work. So, you know, if a man is, you know, staying at home, or whether whether he's supporting his wife or his children, is there any support, you know, within your organization that help men to obviously overcome these things?
Okay. That's a fantastic one, which is close to my heart, because Wi-Fi is for men, because I've got boys.
Yeah.
Good afternoon, everybody. My name is Abby Wallachan, and thank you, MC. Thank you, panelists, for having me. We should have more of them. My question is to, well, it's not directly to Dr. Ajayi, but it stems from your question, actually. So it's your question that I've been pondering upon. Maybe someone in the audience can help us with it, or the panelists. And that's the question of how to get the new arrivals in the country to come to a seminar. I'm thinking, do you go to the airport, stand there and say, are you a newbie or what? How can you get that done? Because it's needed. Thank you.
I will answer that your question. Now, one of the requirements when you relocate to a country is to report to your mission. Any of us, did we do it?
No.
No. So it will be very difficult for us to capture that population. And that was why I said, before they even leave the shores of Nigeria, we're looking to put something in place where they will get a half a day awareness at the British High Commission or the British Council that would explain to them the rate of unemployment, the this, that, everything that you can, you know, the basic things that you need to prepare yourself mentally, and all this, I will kill you, that they say to their children, that the child will go to school, and I will kill you, that will say innocently. Say to the devotees that we think we want to be generally killed. So those are the sort of things. Sorry, I can't take any question anymore. I can't take any question anymore. If you have more questions, please, we will, please write it down, please. Because every question, I'm conscious of the fact that we will be missing some key questions. Now, I'm conscious of the time, it is 4 o'clock, right? I get very teachy. I'm a freak when it comes to timing. I'm sorry, it's something that I'm working on. God help me. Now, yes, I am working on it, but you tell me something is going to start at 4, I'm there 5 minutes before. You tell me it's going to finish at 4, I'm carrying my bag and ready to go at 4. So I'm sort of struggling with myself now that this session is going beyond 4 o'clock. But bear with me. Now, don't worry, you said yours is a suggestion, madam. Yes?
Yes.
A comment. Okay, don't worry. We'll take it, don't worry. But let us, the key thing, the only thing that will make this session different from what we have had previously is setting up this committee. Now, like I said, the groups that brought this happen today will be part of that committee. Now, I think it is imperative, but correct me if I'm wrong, and that is why I will throw it open, that we need someone in the nurses group, because every nurse, I'm sure, we still have some of them in the house, right? Really? Yes. When it comes to safeguarding, that is their baby. We need the nurses, the Nigerian Nurses Association on board, right? That is what. We need a pastor and an imam on board. You know why? Because these are the places people run to. I have heard people saying, you know, it is because of your sin, that's why you have mental health.
Yeah.
Right? So we need these people on board so that if they do not know, they can learn. Right? And then anyone who is really interested, who is committed, because let me tell you, this is not something you're going to be part of and just for the fun of the name,
yeah,
you will work hard. Because as we all know, Paul said it in the morning, for those of you who missed it, 2/3 of our children are dying. We are losing our future generation right in front of us. We cannot continue to sit down and think that other people would do it for us. No, we have to take charge and start doing things. So my question now is, as a member of the audience, and I consider everyone here, because you've taken your time to be here today as a stakeholder for this, what mandate do you want to give to the committee? One, what do you want to, and how do you want them to go about it? Because the ultimate thing is for us to key into government policy formulation. That's why you see all this talk and talk and talk. If we can begin to influence government policies, that's what today is all about. So for the next 10 minutes, right, I believe that I'm speaking for all of us. I'm not taking any questions.
No question, let's
see. You need to contribute.
Don't worry, we'll remind people of that event, don't worry. There's another event coming up next week, we'll remind people of, now let us deal with today's issue. So please, what do you want to remember today for, and maybe next time you see an invite for this, you're more than happy, because you know that there is a group that is working on what we have discussed. I will take 4 recommendations, and the first person, the lady in blue, yes, at the back. And there was somebody else that had a recommendation, I said, that is 2 weeks. No, don't worry, she was first one for recommendation. I'll come back to you, don't worry, I'll come back to you. I'll come back to you. Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you so much for putting this together, and I've truly been educated today. I'm going to take away a lot of information. But one thing I noticed that I wanted to share was that the young man that spoke so eloquently and had this passion that you can actually see, if not touch. But the thing about it is that, what are we going to do back home in Nigeria when these young, passionate children of ours go back home to start projects? Because we've seen this happen. They get so disappointed because the bribing, the things that are not working, they are not used to it. So how, what are we going to put in place so when they get home, such gaps don't become too big for them to handle. They can still push on into the good we that brought them out of Europe. That's one thing.
No, I can't take option. You have to take my option. You can talk to your friend for other people. If you have a question or you want to do it. No, I can't take question. I need to. What are you guys going to
have
to do? I have a suggestion.
Somebody
else. Look, she first.
Vice President of Nigerian Nurses Association. Okay, that's good then.
Okay. But what I want to suggest to the group is that I am so glad that we have this group. Now I know the resources to tap into. Because in your own estate, Nigerian Nurses Association is having a lead now. When you have fund days, you have all sorts of people who come to the fund day. Put a boot in there. Be part of the TRA. I'm the secretary and also panel. So I make sure now. Tenant residential,
I don't know.
Because we are talking about this group of people with communities. Who are you going to get those youths?
Yes.
You will get them in here. But if you're a tenant resident association member, be a president, go there for the election, and be somebody there. Then have the power to say what happens.
Yes.
And that's what Nigerians are saying, including me at the moment. We get funding for the fund day, there's a lot of money around, and you set up things like this, and you will be surprised how many youths will come to you there and then. You know, these are things people can do, and we get all of them in. And
fantastic. In fact, nurses, I mandated the lady with that, you guys need to be on board.
My suggestion is that basically I believe that you should actually go into churches and mosques, because that's where the most black people are congregating every Sunday, every day of the week. I go to a church which is full of Igbos, and they come with their children and their babies and everything until like 10 or 30 at night. So if you're able to go into churches and mosques, you will get a lot of people.
We do that already, but as this group, as this working committee, it's setting up, as this working committee is what we need to take up, because we do it individually, but we need to do it as a group.
We're with you.
Great event. Grateful for those that put this together, even to everybody that attended. It's a lot of effort. The only addition I just want to make is for the group, it's nice that we come together as a community to dwell on our issues and look for solutions. But that should be a step into maybe a representative of each group feeding into statutory arrangements, because that's where we can represent our community and we can influence policies and take things back and forth. We can take our case to statutory arrangement, maybe bigger charity organizations that is outside of Nigerian or African folding. Also, we can bring relevant information back. So that way, it's not just inward looking, we're also tapping into necessary resources. There was a session yesterday at the CTO where I co-facilitated some, I think it's C4B,
C4B
meant to be African networking. And the message is like, we need to be an hard block. We need to be very relevant, and that's for networking. And being there to address issues like concerns, we need to be at the right place at the right time.
Now, everyone can agree with me that this lady, we need to call this lady to the
office. She is of the SMB.
What does the SMB mean?
I was talking to you.
You were at the place on BBC, aren't you?
Yeah.
And I would. You didn't tell us
a bit. I would say, you tell us a bit. I share so far never would
call them. Okay.
I will close it up.
So, will the House agree with me that we need this woman of God?
Yes.
No, she's not going. We have her name and number, don't worry. Will everybody agree with me that we need our God?
Yes.
Yeah? Last but not the least.
Thank you. I'd like to congratulate everybody for today. Chief Minister, this is I actually do International Day of African Youth, which is June 16th. And the new chairman of Kaluk actually reminded me that we need to plan this. But having listened to the event today, I don't think we need to do an idea, because what we always do is what has happened today. And I'm so excited and so I congratulate you. The only thing I think we miss out is radicalization. How do we prevent radicalization? And the suggestion I want to make to the committee is that if we have a safeguarding, a Nigerian safeguarding committee, if any child is going to be taken away or there's any problem or they're safeguarding with other elderly or with children, the social workers or the police needs to contact us. That in our community we have a safeguarding committee. So once they contact us, we will be able to solve the problem to say this is how we are going to handle. Because there's a lot of cultural misunderstanding. I've been a victim of safeguarding myself because of cultural misunderstanding. It's actually my sister here that actually rescued me. They don't understand though, because once we see somebody in need, we spontaneously embrace them. We've forgotten that the culture is different. And by the time we know they misinterpret, they say, why are you helping them? Because you want to benefit something. So we see a child at risk, everybody's a child, everybody's our mother, and so on. So we need, if we have a standard professionals, they will be able to check with us to say, there's a Nigerian at risk, or what do we do? Then we'll be able to protect and safeguard our community. Thank you. That's as always, thank you. That was brilliant, right? That was really, really brilliant because then, you see, and that was what I was waiting for us to say, that this working committee would be the point of reference across the UK when people, like, was Florence that was saying that all they need to do is, you know, have that inroad into the community because most times they don't know who to talk to. They don't know where to go to.
Yeah.
When people sit in the back of the office formulating policies, is, you know, it's like out from their own experience. But when you then have someone from that community who can then make them see things from a different perspective,
yeah,
it is always, always different,
yeah,
very good. So, on that note,
before you finish, I think just to embrace further, yes, we live in London,
but there are. No, I said across the UK, I didn't say London.
Okay.
I said across the UK. I'm conscious of the fact that because my role is a national role, and I have responsibility for people outside London. So, it's a national thing. So what will happen? There's a lady, a member of CANU, who resides in Birmingham. She was here. I have a question. She just stepped up now. So she will be taking this event to Birmingham. So it's not the one-off. Now, the next thing now is just two things. There is a very, very huge gap that I feel that we can use as a vehicle. And that is our movie industry. Because a lot of us watch movies, Nollywood, and the rest of it.
Thank you.
I think we need to start working with them to project and educate us properly. Now, there's a lady in the house who on Friday, she's having an event on Friday about modern day slavery. We're going to do that just 2 minutes because if she was in the midst of her white colleagues who were, you know, given red carpet and all that, and all that was as well. So I'll just give her 2 minutes to talk about her movie, the premiere on Friday. She's done, there was one she did before. Every movie of hers that I have seen has always had to do with social issues. And I think we need to start hearing, we need people like her on board as well, so that we can use that media as a vehicle to reach out to people. So, those call her RSA.
Good afternoon, everyone. My name is Rosalie Sani Ajose, but they call me RSA. Thank you, Ms. Yemisi, MBE. And thank you to all the people that have put this event together today. I'm happy to be here. This is a movie coming out about modern day slavery. What I believe, like she said, I believe some of us would like to do films that make people laugh, that make people, you crack your rib. But I believe in humanity. I'm a nurse, I'm a theater nurse in the UK, trained here. I work with a lot of people that they're talking about safeguarding. The NHS invests so much money in training us about safeguarding, about issues like this. So I believe making a movie that has a theme that relating with human life. So I want you all to come out. Don't think about the money. You're not making it richer. I want you to come out to support the victim
of modern day slavery. This movie, it is not just something that put a pen and paper together to write, it's someone else's story. Somebody that has been abused, somebody that has been tortured in the hand of a human being like myself and yourself. So I want you to come out and support this film. It's good to keep talking about or to write modern day slavery safeguarding in print, in papers, but when you actually see it being dramatized in motion picture, you see somebody being stabbed, they won't show you how they do the stabbing on TV because it's too gory. But when we dramatized it and you come and watch it, you will actually feel the pain yourself to say, come on guys, you got to stop this. So Nollywood is a platform, it's a huge platform we can use to reach out to the young people, to bring them on board, to get them off the street. Thank you.
So, you guys agree that we need Nollywood on board?
Yeah.
We're going to work. I think this was missed, but it was missed. Someone did mention it, because what Chief Mrs. alluded to is what they're already doing. But what I said to the CEO of Safran is that this, the working committee will key into this. But please, if you do not have a copy of this, please make sure you have. Can I make photocopies? Okay. No, what I want is for people, because I know that some representatives of churches and mosques have come, they can take it away and share it. You don't have enough for them to take one. Okay, so they said you can make copies. So please take it away. Your church, your mosque, attending event, community event, please, please share with them what they said they're doing. Or what they said they're doing is Nigerian Center for Safeguarding Support. And the address is Backing Enterprise Center, 50 Cambridge Road, Backing Essex. Obviously, as this committee grows, we will need center, because center in Essex, I'm in North London, I'm in whatever. So this is part of what we will be doing. Now, I told you I'm still working on not being whatever on time. It gets my back off. Now, has anybody here given us the email address? The reason why I say that is that for us to achieve anything, we need to give ourselves a timeline. If there's a timeline to things, say you achieve it because you're working towards it. Guys, can I say to the house that in the next 3 months, we will put something together and send to everybody present today? And that would comprise of the names of the organizations in the working committee, the terms of reference, the aims and objectives, and when we send it to you, if you have suggestions on how we can key into government departments and the rest of it, please feedback that. I think one of the things we need to do is to create like a mailbox for the group. I'm not an IT person, but we'll surely get someone to do that. So we will do that in 3 months' time. Yeah? Sorry, are we in agreement? Is 3 months enough?
No.
It's too far. No, what I said, my 3 months is when we have done the work. But what you're looking for is. Okay, the immediate action, please be there, the immediate action will be that this group will set up a WhatsApp group. And please, if you haven't given us your email address, that's the only way we can feedback to you. No, you don't have to use it. If whatever you feel comfortable with, if you give it to us, so that once the WhatsApp group is set up, we will feed to you the progress. And in 3 months' time, we must have reached a milestone. And that's what I was alluding to. We must have reached a milestone that will get back to you. Okay? Are we okay with that?
Yes.
Fine. So, on that note, yes, sorry? Sorry, I know there was a vote of thanks on the... I recognize somebody from Nigerian Association of Police Officers. Please, come on. What is your role again? Are you still the vice president of the chair or the vice chair? Which one are you? Now, you see, we have so many Nigerians working in the Metropolitan Police. And like I was saying earlier, we talk about the negativity, not the positive. These are some of the people that are securing the community that we live in. I'm about to give you 30 seconds.
good evening, gentlemen, and ladies and gentlemen. I wasn't wanting to speak, but since I've been following the sport, I've been a police officer within the Met for the last 16 years. And currently, I'm working on the transformation team and trying to, like, you know, save the Met some money.
I'm thankful for Saturday.
No, it's not cutting people, but it's trying to make it more effective. And during my career, I have actively worked within the youth department, schools, response team, and also I'm one of the founder of the Nigerian Police Association in the UK.
Fantastic. You see why I think this is so important? Because you will be on that working committee as well. Do you agree with me?
Yes.
Right. On that note, it's 4:20. On that note, somebody, we're talking about people that are on the stage. Next week, Thursday, is it?
15th of June.
Is it Thursday or which week?
Thursday.
Next week, Thursday, Association of British Nigerian Law Enforcement Officers are working in collaboration with an organization that is based in Nigeria, looking at reintegration. So a lot of people talk about going back home, not knowing what to do, not knowing how to fit back into the system. If you want information on that, if you want to be part of that, it's on the 15th of June from 7 to 9 p.m. And what's the address?
Law Center, Camberwell. Post it. Let me have your address.
So please, this all still goes back to the same guy. It's about, because there are a lot of, I was at Hamantua Detention Center yesterday, and one of the challenges that people are facing is, oh, I don't know what to do, blah, 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 blah. And even for you, in terms of, yes, you're not integrating, but you need support. But don't worry, you in particular, I will hand you over to the chair of the Diaspora Committee, Honorable Rita Ochi, okay? You and your team. Trust me on that one. So, to everyone that has taken their time to attend today, we are on behalf of the NUS, ABLE, World of Hope, Saffron, who else? Africa, Mansag, more importantly, the Nigerian High Commission. We are grateful. Obasanjo solicitors, we are grateful and we say thank you for taking the time to be part of today's event. Like I said, this is not your usual or normal event. You will see things happening. So we will keep to our timeline. We will update you and we'll come back to you. On that note, thank you very much for your time. And we hope to see you, because this is not a one-off.
Yes.
We're going to have another one very soon. Thank you and safe journey home.
Okay, it's been a very long day, and I'm very sure, you know, a lot of you have followed all the proceeding. Since about 10 o'clock, I mean, I got here just about 11 o'clock. Safeguarding the community is a big issue. It involves everything, but the most important thing is this was brought to you live in courtesy of Niger Diaspora, bringing it as it's happening. I'm on my way now to the studio where we will bring into you the Niger voices. As usual, my name is Olayomi Koike, and thank you very much for everyone that have watched and everyone that have stayed tuned. And I'll speak to you in just about 2 hours from now on the Star Radio. Download the apps, and then you can also follow it on the Facebook, and likewise on the YouTube, you can watch it live. Thank you very much, and hope to speak to you soon. Again, Olayomi Koike is my name.